the marked version of our heritage talks, today sponsored by the Open Memorial Library, the Salisbury Association Historical Society. Claudia Kane would like to tell you that the exits are there and there. The laboratory is behind that door down the dismal hallway. You can find it if necessary. A special day today, March 17th. As a matter of fact, it's a special day in New England. It's a holiday in Boston. Because March 17th happens to be the day that the British Army left Boston back in 1776. So the good fathers of Boston said, March 17th should really be a holiday. Let's do things. Let's have a parade. Let's do all sorts of things. We all know March 17th as another aspect to it. Bill Bucherry is here to tell us all about that aspect and how those people, the Irish, came to the Northwest Corner.
Thank you very much. I've been told it works better that way. First of all, to all of you who do have a great deal of Irish blood in you, my apologies. I'm not one of you. I did wear my Illuminations tie for the Book of Kells, and that's about as close as I get. But being that it was St. Patrick's Day, it seemed only appropriate to focus on the Irish and their immigration here to Salisbury in my presentation to you this afternoon. Just a little aside, I do have some people to thank. First of all, a lady by the name of Pat Conroy, who has put together, she's worked with the University of Connecticut's Iron Workers Project and put together a pretty detailed history of St. Bridget's Church down in Cornwall. And there's a direct connection to some of the things that I'm going to talk about today. And certainly a thank you to Judy Jacobs, the president of the Fallsville Chicanan Historical Society. She sat down with me and spent some time and offered me quite a few resources. Thank you to Ed Kirby, who made me aware of Pat Conroy's existence, and his energy and enthusiasm to this day are an inspiration. And then one person without whom I would be, as a friend of mine used to say, a lost ball in high weeds, and that is our town historian and my mother-in-law. Before I get into the actual impact here on Salisbury, a little background. And I got into this thinking that I knew why the Irish had come here to America in general, and specifically to Connecticut and New England. I found I knew less than I should. And certainly there was an influence of religion. Some of you may know this in great detail. It all changed for Christians in general when the Roman Emperor Constantine converted to Christianity back about 305 AD, or CE, if I'm politically correct. And then the great story of St. Patrick, who it turns out wasn't alone in converting the Irish to Christianity. There was also another man who operated about the same time, just in another part of the island called Palladius, who also, and of course we don't hear about him because St. Patrick was the one who the chroniclers of the day focused on. And that was a long time ago, about 431, that in the 5th century. Then, of course, was Henry VIII, and he really gave the initial impetus to drive a wedge between Great Britain and Ireland by giving up the Catholic faith, specifically, back in 1532, and that whole Protestant-Catholic struggle went on for a long, long time. The Elizabethan rivalry with Catholic Spain had an impact on the feelings and the people of Ireland. There was a brief attempt to try and bring in Spain as an ally to free the Irish Catholic people from the English Protestants. That didn't work very well. And then, essentially, the expansion of British and Protestant control over the island of Ireland back in the 17th century. Some of my students might enjoy this. I actually put a little video in here, if I can only get it to work. We'll see about that. This video talks a little bit about, talks a little bit about some of the changes to land ownership in Ireland that really was another impetus for the Irish to leave eventually. No one ever really wants to leave their home. The reasons have to be pretty strong. And certainly over the centuries, for many Irish, they became strong. Will it work?
This map illustrates the progressive loss of land ownership by the Roman Catholic Irish in the aftermath of the Reformation during a period of increased settlement by English Protestants. In 1641, Irish Catholics owned approximately 59% of the land in Ireland. Here, counties marked in solid green indicate that the majority of land in those areas was owned by Catholics. In the north, however, in counties subject to the most direct English and Scottish influence, Catholics already owned less than 50% of the land. In 1688, the Catholic King of Great Britain, James II, was deposed. Attempting to regain his throne, he made his way to Ireland, where the newly crowned Protestant king, William III, defeated him and his Irish Catholic supporters by 1691. Irish land ownership by this time had decreased to less than 1 out of every 4 acres on the island. The land forfeited by James II and his supporters further reduced Catholic land ownership in Ireland, which by 1703 had fallen to 14%. Thus, in 18th century Ireland, the vast majority of the land was owned by Protestants, who represented only about 10% of the population. The control of Ireland by this small ruling class became known as the Protestant Ascendancy.
I let that go. See, students, I do pay attention to words, consultant words, I So, obviously, for decades and decades, discontent was growing among the Irish in Ireland.
This map illustrates the progressive loss of land ownership by the Roman Catholic Irish in the aftermath of the Reformation during a period of increased settlement by...
Let's see if we can get it to go back now. Oh, it's going to require a little manual labor. So this discontent that was brewing on Ireland was, needless to say, fed by the Age of Revolutions. The first of which was our own American Revolution. Initially, this was a help to the Irish because many of the troops that were sent here to quell the revolution had originally been stationed in Ireland, and so those troops were removed from Ireland and put less pressure on the population there. There were definitely some reforms initiated by the British government to try and stem the tide of discontent. There were only so many revolutions they could deal with at any one time. But the Protestant ascendancy and the hardening of those religious feelings limited the extent of Catholic participation and representation in the Irish Parliament. Then came the French Revolution, and for a time, Irish nationalists made an effort to try and ally with the French and create an invasion of Ireland by the French. Needless to say, that failed. Then William Pitt the Younger became Prime Minister of Great Britain, and in an effort to try and consolidate the power of the British Crown, dissolved the Irish Parliament. So by 1801, even the little bit of representative government that the Irish enjoyed was now gone. The Industrial Revolution put additional pressures on the Irish. The natural industrial tendency to create colonies, to bring in raw materials and provide for extra markets certainly had an impact on the British-Irish relationship. Ireland did provide raw materials, mostly agricultural, to Britain, and Britain controlled the prices that the Irish could get for that, thereby lowering the value of the agricultural products that the island specialized in. But because of improvements in diet and overall health, the rural population of Ireland was booming, making the number of poor landless farmers even greater, and therefore less able to afford the rent that was being charged by their British and Protestant masters. And the evictions of these landless farmers began to multiply. And if that wasn't bad enough, then we get nature imposing its wrath. One thinks now, well, okay, there was a potato blight. It was a fungus that affected crops. Why was that so devastating? Why didn't they eat other things? Well, first of all, that kind of attitude doesn't really understand how popular the potato had become in Europe. It was unknown to Europe until it was brought back by Spanish explorers, because it originally came from South America. And scientific investigation showed that it was a highly nutritious food. It was relatively easy to grow, and it increased food production in Europe dramatically. This led to a population explosion in Europe. England and Wales doubled in population between 1801 and 1851. Ireland too doubled in population. And that was without the expansion of industry or improvement in agricultural technique. They hadn't learned how to farm there. They hadn't gained any industrial production that might free up people to do other things. It was simply because of the ease of growth of the potato and the reliance on that food source. So much so that the potato became the staple of Ireland. Many Irish survived on milk and potatoes alone. In fact, there were quite a few families that relied on potatoes for all three of their meals. It was an interesting quote that I came across. By the early 1840s, almost one half of the Irish population had become entirely dependent upon the potato, specifically on just one or two high-yielding varieties. There are some of my seventh grade students in the audience, as I mentioned to you, and one of the things that they would be able to tell you that is that economic diversity is very important to progress. Well, that's equally true for agriculture. Agricultural diversity is also important to protect against just the sort of situations that came to be in Ireland. And the potato wasn't just used for human food. Its stalks were used in building to thatch the roofs of the huts. And the peels were fed to livestock. In 1845, problems began, and they lasted for approximately 4 years. The fungus, we're not quite sure how it got to Europe. We think it came, or historians think it came on some tainted potatoes that had come from the Americas. And the crop failure didn't just happen in Ireland, it happened in other parts of Europe as well. But because of the Irish dependence on the potato, it had a dramatic effect. Approximately 1 million Irish died of starvation and fever because their ability to fight off diseases was so compromised that they suffered dramatically. And ultimately, another 2 million were forced to leave. They were forced to emigrate. In fact, as we can see from this map, dramatic decreases in the population of the entire island between 1841 and 1851. The population of Ireland was halved by the potato famine. Okay, so they emigrated. Did they all come to the United States? No. But quite a few did. And quite a few specifically came and stayed in New England. And there were some factors that helped in that. First of all were British laws themselves, the British Passenger Acts, beginning in 1803. These were an attempt to keep workers in the British territories. Obviously, it's hard to have an industrial nation if you're losing your workers. So, sure, you could emigrate, sure, you could leave Great Britain and go someplace else, as long as it was another British territory. So emigration to Canada was much cheaper than to the United States. And it was much easier as well, because you could leave from any port in Ireland to sail to Canada, but in order to come to the United States, you actually had to go to Great Britain. Could only leave, I believe it was through Portsmouth. Okay, so what about Canada? Why didn't they stay there? Well, quite frankly, the prospects for jobs were better in the United States. Industrial expansion during the mid-19th century was going along at an incredible pace, far faster than it was in Canada. And quite frankly, there were better prospects as far as the Irish Catholics were concerned for justice, get away from British rule. Compared to other immigrant groups, the Irish really had very little in the way of money, very little in the way of skills as well. So when they did arrive in Canada, they literally walked south. And many found employment as they progressed. In addition, because they had spent a great deal of money to get to Canada, they had very little left, and if they could afford to sail once again from Canada, they could only go as far as New England. Well, good thing for us and good thing for them, that between 1820 and 1860, there was an industrial boom going on in New England. And there were a great many jobs that required for lots of unskilled labor. One of the areas of employment was canal building. One example were the Enfield and Farmington canals, where more than 400 Irish immigrants were employed. Here in our corner of the world, the canals that were built in nearby Falls Village were constructed partly through Irish immigrant labor. That's a very long story, the canals in Falls Village. Ultimately, they failed as an economic venture, but you can still see that there was some progress made in their building because there are stone walls, particularly near the hydroelectric plant that still exists from that time. The other thing that was going on here in the north, and particularly in the northeast, was the construction of railroads. A great deal of unskilled labor was used in that, and the New Haven and Hartford railroads were growing by leaps and bounds. but they weren't the only ones. Mining too, sorry, I forget that. I'm going to be going there in just a moment to talk more about mining. By 1840, more than half of the Irish in the United States had settled in New England. So how'd they end up here? Well, this was one major way, the Housatonic Railroad, the first edition, if you will. The Housatonic Railroad Company was chartered in May of 1836 to build a line from Bridgeport to the Massachusetts state line along the Housatonic River. It still exists today. Regular service began from Bridgeport to New Haven, to New Milford on February 9, 1840. The line reached the state line at Canaan, now North Canaan, on December 1, 1842. There were a great many Irish immigrants employed in building the line from Bridgeport to this area. And it allowed those immigrants to be introduced to the northwest corner and take advantage of the employment opportunities that existed here. And what were those employment opportunities? The iron mines, the iron works that were in their prime during those years. One of the biggest employers during the mid-1800s was the Ames Iron Works on the western bank of the Housatonic, just north of the Great Falls. If you don't know about the Ames Ironworks, that was another lecture. But it was a major employer in our area. When you wander through the land where this ironworks existed, it's hard to imagine that these buildings that were so heavily used in industry and the construction of great iron products ever existed there. But they did. This photograph was taken during the mid-19th century, we think late 1850s. And it shows the Housatonic River here in the front. This is the line of the Housatonic Railroad. This track bed still exists today. And in order to service the Ames Iron Works, at one time just north of the Great Falls, a spur was built, a covered railroad bridge across the Housatonic River to feed into the train yard that serviced the Ames Ironworks. Now, the ironworks themselves employed a great many skilled laborers. The new puddling techniques that Horatio Ames employed there required some expertise and some experience. The vast majority of the skilled workers at the Ames Ironworks were English, the independent craftsmen. And in fact, Horatio Ames was one of the first entrepreneurs to build housing to entice married, sober workers to work and stay in his employ. The unskilled laborers were mostly the Irish immigrants, and for the most part, they lived across the river in present-day Falls Village, Canaan. In fact, there's a road in Falls Village that today is called Dublin Road. This is one of the Google Map satellite visions of present-day Falls Village. And here is, this was the string of floats that warns people away from the Great Falls, which are right down here, just last fall and all of our storms, this string of floats was broken. It's all piled up on the one side. But on, as you can see, on the east side of the Housatonic River, just above the Great Falls, there is this road that goes across like that, and it is called Dublin Road. And that was the primary neighborhood for the unskilled Irish laborers who worked at the Ames Ironworks. And in fact, to this day, you can still, if you wander down one of these driveways, you can still see what is known as St. Patrick's Cemetery. And you can see many headstones from that day. Back in 1988, there was still a publication, a newspaper created in North Canaan called the Free Press. I'm sure that many of you remember it. And back in honor of St. Patrick's Day in 1988, a lady by the name of Mildred Trocola wrote an article really wondering where the Irish had gone, because she had heard about this St. Patrick's Cemetery. She knew about the little chapel called St. Patrick's that was in Falls Village, but when she went to look through the phone book, there were very few Irish-sounding names that she could find. So she did a little homework, and she did learn that Dublin Road was originally called the Highway from Six Rod Road, which is present-day Sand Road, to the Great Falls. It ran from Point of Rocks to the present Dublin Road. At some point, it became known as the Road Through Dublin. Maps made after the 1930s show it as Dublin Road. The structures that the Irish workers lived in no longer exist. In some cases, you can find the evidence of foundation holes, but evidently their dwellings were not terribly well made. I read where they were referred to as ramshackle and have since been demolished. I guess I didn't get rid of the red circle. But anyway, here we go. Now, obviously, Irish Catholics require the church. The trouble was that there wasn't a great Catholic presence anywhere in the original 13 colonies, except in Maryland. And some may remember that the colony of Maryland was founded by Cecil Calvert, a Catholic in Great Britain who was seeking to find a refuge from the persecution that was going on there. He was not successful in establishing it as a majority Catholic colony, but certainly there was a connection to the church in Rome, because the very first Catholic diocese in the United States was located in Baltimore back in 1789. By 1808, there had been enough immigration in the United States that Connecticut Catholics received a diocese, not necessarily of their own, but certainly of New England. They belonged to the Diocese of Boston. And its first bishop, interestingly enough, was not Irish, but French, a refugee from the French Revolution by the name of Jean Severus, or Chevreuse. In 1843, because of the growth in the Catholic population in Connecticut, Hartford was declared to be a see, which is the next smallest administrative unit beyond a diocese. Here in the northwest corner, those Catholics who did leave here were visited by priests from Albany, Poughkeepsie, and Norwalk. And by 1848, these people were saying Mass in private homes. By the time 1850 rolled along, the Reverend Christopher Moore the Reverend Christopher Moore was a pastor from Norwalk. He was one of the pastors who came to this area to say Mass. And the numbers had grown to such a degree where it was no longer feasible to say Mass in the private homes of the Catholic people in the area. So he secured the use of the old schoolhouse in Amesville for saying Masses in 1850. Well, not everybody in the community was happy about that. And somebody unknown to Reverend Moore complained. He didn't really pay the complaint much mind until one Sunday in June of 1850, the congregation reached the door of the schoolhouse and it was locked. And oh, by the way, this structure, which does mark the school in the Amesville village of the Amesville hamlet of Salisbury, does still exist. It's a private home. So that the congregation was forced to cross back over the river to Falls Village, and Mass was said under an apple tree on Beatty Hill. But clearly, something had to be done. The numbers of Catholic worshipers were growing. Obviously, they needed a home. They needed a place to worship. In 1850, Irish-born Bernard O'Reilly becomes the second bishop of Hartford. And he appoints the Reverend Peter Kelly to succeed Reverend Moore. It's interesting that Reverend Kelly was referred to by one historian as one of the clerical characters of the day. I would have loved to have seen that. Evidently, one of the people that he charmed was Horatio Ames, the owner of the Ames Ironworks. And I had to put this quote in because I find it remarkable. The superintendent of the Ironworks, the Ames Ironworks, and I'm guessing this is Horatio Ames from the description in the quote, and it should be a phlegmatic Teuton, accosted Reverend Kelly and admitted the presence of the priest was for the well-being of the town. Horatio was always about keeping the sobriety and family nature of his workers on the up and up so that they would come to work regularly. Well, Reverend Kelly established the parish of St. Patrick. It was the very first Catholic parish in northwestern Connecticut, founded in 1851. The church that was built was this one. This was the original Church of St. Patrick. It was located on the present-day Warren Turnpike. Supposedly, it was the only Catholic church on the Housatonic Railroad line between, I think it was Danbury and Pittsfield. Unfortunately, in 1915, this church burned down when a passing train threw some sparks onto some dry grass behind this structure. But the stained glass windows that you see here were preserved, and they were included in the rebuilt Church of St. Patrick, which was built on B.B. Hill Road in later years. It has since become a private home. But if you listen to the name, Church of St. Patrick, founded by Reverend Peter Kelly, appointed by Bernard O'Reilly, I think you get the idea. Well, the Ames Ironworks began to decline with some difficult economic situations, the Panic of 1857, some poor choices by Horatio Ames with regard to business practices and focus of production, and ultimately the ironworks declared bankruptcy in 1863. It actually stayed in business and was producing goods right up, even months past Ames' death in 1871. But with the closing of the Ames Iron Works, the employment opportunities for the Irish immigrants on that side of the river, on this side of the river, but close to the river, went into decline. And the bulk of the Irish population moved into the center of what we now call Lakeville, which in the earliest days was called Furnace Village. 400 Catholic adults were living in Lakeville by 1874. Many of them worked in the ore mines, the Ore Hill Mine and the Davis Mine. And interestingly enough, in those early days, before the Church of St. Mary was built, Mass was said twice a month in the Academy building. The man who transferred the parish seat from Falls Village to Lakeville was Reverend Henry Lynch. He did that in February of 1875. The Church of St. Mary was dedicated on January 16th of 1876. And it was built almost entirely, from money, that's supposed to be money, donated by miners in the Ore Hill and Davis ore beds. Now, I'm going to show you a list of the names of the pastors at the Church of St. Mary from 1875 to 1957. Let's see if you can catch the two. Lynch, Fox, Donahoe, Bannon, well, that should be Donahue, Lawler, Flynn, Noonan. I think there's an ethnic trend there. Now, relationships between the Irish Catholics and the mostly Protestant folks who were living here in Lakeville and Salisbury in those days were not always cordial. In fact, there was one very famous incident in 1883 that focused on a cross. And the conflict was so noteworthy that it made the New York Times on August 27, 1883, this article appeared in the Times, titled, "Disgusted with Images, a Religious War in a Connecticut Town. Excited over the fancy of a Catholic priest, why Lakeville storekeepers were boycotted." Lakeville, a pretty little town on the borders of Lake Wenanskapomek, is just now in a ferment very nearly akin to that which New York enjoyed during the discussion of Mr. Salmi Morse's Passion Play. I did not investigate that. The Reverend Father Henry J. Lynch has been in charge of the Catholic parish at this place for the last 8 years. He is an active and enterprising man and has done much to forward the interests of his flock. When he first took charge, the Catholics worshipped in a little wooden structure situated in a patch of swampy ground. Now they have a new and handsome church surrounded by well-kept grounds, and the priest lives in a neat little cottage lately erected. Last October, Father Lynch put up in the main walk leading from the street to the church door a cross 12 feet high, on which was a figure of the Savior very little smaller than life size and executed with considerable skill. The face bears an expression of pain, and from a wound in the side, blood appears to be trickling. This emblem aroused the good people of Lakeville, who regarded it as a sacrilege. They openly denounced the priest's action in placing the figure there and talked of lawsuits to compel its removal. Before their opposition had been organized so that it could act with effect, another report came
to their ears that only increased the prevailing excitement. Father Lynch, some time ago, bought a piece of ground and began the erection of a building to be used as a convent and parochial school. It was rumored that Father Lynch proposed to adorn this building with other realistic representations of scenes from the life of Christ. Lakeville's Protestant people, probably overlooking the fact that what Father Lynch chose to do with his own property was exclusively a matter of the reverend gentleman's own business, drew up the following address. We, the undersigned, citizens of Lakeville, respectfully remonstrate against the erection of images representing sacred characters already exposed or to be hereafter exposed to public view on grounds adjacent to the village of Lakeville. Believing that such display is not in harmony with American ideas and customs, it is shocking to the sensibilities of many and entirely at variance with the sentiments and wishes of a great portion of the people of this community. We respectfully ask the Reverend H.J. Lynch to use his influence in procuring the removal of the images now erected and in preventing the erection of others of like character. Oh my. 72 people, among them nearly all the storekeepers of Lakeville, signed this address and appointed ex-governor Alexander Hamilton Holly, T.L. Norton, cashier of the bank, and Mr. Tupper, a justice of the peace, to wait upon Father Lynch and urge him to accede to what they term the sentiments of the people. The committee called on the priest and were received with great courtesy. They explained the object of their visit, and Father Lynch, when they had concluded their oration, showed them through the new buildings and dwelt lovingly upon the great advantages that would accrue to Lakeville from having such an institution within its borders. He said nothing about removing the images, but he was so gracious about other things that the committee felt certain that he would oblige them in that respect. And they so reported to the public-spirited committee of 72 who had sent them. They thought that until last Monday. Heretofore, the Catholics have dealt largely with the Lakeville storekeepers, and the bulk of the orders for goods was received on Mondays. Last Monday, the storekeepers who had signed the address noticed with some surprise that no Catholics came to deal with them. Tuesday and Wednesday passed, and yet no orders from the members of Father Lynch's flock. The storekeepers began to realize that they had been boycotted. At first they laughed. That was on Wednesday. On Thursday they swore. And on Friday, they were not only very angry, but very much alarmed. The Catholics had been spending about $1,000 a week with them, and they saw the profit in that amount of molasses and soap sliding from their grasp into the cash drawers of the merchants of the neighboring town of Salisbury. They concluded to retaliate by making war on the priest and his congregation. Senator Barnum, who is known to fame as an extensive dealer in long-eared livestock during the campaign in which one Mr. Tilden was a figure of some importance, owns a mill at Lakeville and is engaged in industries that employ many hands, among them about 1,600 Catholics. The anti-Lynch people sent a delegation to the senator, and the delegation returned with the statement that Mr. Barnum would discharge every Catholic, in his employ if the images were not removed from the churchyard. They went also to the railroad officer, who it is reported said that Father Lynch could not hire any special trains to convey people to the dedication of his new convent on the 5th of next month. Then they held a meeting and voted not to give any more money to any Catholic charity while Father Lynch remained in charge of the parish. The speeches made at this meeting were very violent. A.F. Roberts, the keeper of one of the stores, was the orator of the occasion. He denounced Father Lynch as a drunkard and an ignoramus. Mr. Roberts' long and intimate connection with the salt mackerel and brown sugar warranted him in expressing the opinion that Father Lynch's writing was very poor and his sentences ungrammatical. One storekeeper said that Father Lynch had always paid his bills, but this Mr. Roberts denied. Father Lynch, he said, owed him a bill of $10 and wouldn't pay it, and he expected to sue him for it. Mr. Roberts warned his fellow merchants that if they sold anything to Father Lynch, they ran a great risk of not getting paid for it. Father Lynch says that the whole trouble is due to political causes. Almost all of the signers to the petition, he says, are politicians who are jealous because the Catholics have recently elected several of their faith to prominent positions in the town government. The story about Senator Barnum, Father Lynch characterizes as false and absurd. As to the boycotting of tradesmen, Father Lynch says he is in no wise responsible for it, but that his parishioners took that action on their own accord. He says that he remarked when he looked at the address that some of the signers had grown rich on the patronage of Catholics. I'm having trouble to secure railroad trains on the occasion of the dedication of my convent, said he, and I believe that the railroad officers have been influenced by these busybodies. If the company will not give me the use of their road when I tender payment for the same, I shall see to it that the world is duly informed of their bigotry. Bishop McMahon is expected to go to Lakeville in a day or two to look into the quarrel. As the case stands, the dedication is likely to be a very sensational event. I can report to you that the incident drew such attention that the very next day an editorial was written in the New York Times admonishing both sides for their silliness. And ultimately it was resolved, but I have not seen any specific mention of it again. This is the convent and the parochial school that was built and dedicated on September 5th, 1883. And yes, Reverend Lynch got his railroad cars. In fact, some of you remember these buildings do still stand. This is what is now known as the Lakeville Manor. And this is the small structure that sits in front of it, diagonally. Yes? And then there are the iron mines. This is a photograph of miners in the year 1914, so it was a little bit beyond the real heyday of Irish employment there. But the iron mines have been here in Salisbury for a long time. The first mine grant was assigned in 1732. In fact, I read one account, or one historian, who said the most important iron mines in Connecticut were in Salisbury. And mining and manufacturing were the leading industries in the town until the late 19th century. In fact, during the mid-19th century, the mines here in Salisbury were producing more than 5,000 tons of ore a year. And the Oriel mine in particular operated until 1923. What does that have to do with the Irish? Well, from 1850 to 1900, about 80% of the miners at Ore Hill and surrounding diggings were Irish immigrants.
fact, I heard a troubling story. I have not ever been able to document this, but, and I don't tell you to shock you or to try and influence your thoughts in any way. This was a story connected to the iron mines that I thought you might find fascinating. At one point, the owner of the mines decided that he wanted to bring in some cheaper labor. So he brought in a handful of Chinese miners. This was in the late 19th century when they were having to dig fairly deep shafts into the earth in order to expose the veins of ore. These miners, the Chinese miners, went in one day, and I guess they weren't terribly appreciated by the Irish and what other ethnic groups were working in the mines at that point, and they were never seen again. By 1900, the Irish were joined by other ethnic groups, mostly immigrants from southern and eastern Europe, and in this photograph, Charles F. Perkins, who at that time was the assistant superintendent of the Ordell Mines, had gone into Lakeville to pick up the miners. And they're on their way to work. And, you know, if I was a betting man, I would say that not all of those guys look Irish to me. And just to emphasize the life, how life was changing here in Salisbury, particularly in Lakeville, back in 1975, Lila Nash gave a talk to the Salisbury Rotary Club on the history of street signs. And she was talking about Lincoln City Road in particular. And she told a story that she related through her research. On Lincoln City Road, she said, there were the McKinnas, the Gannons, and the Gun Shannons, the Monahans, and the Merediths, and Tony Shobos, and the Codys. There were Irishmen, there were Italians, and there were Polish people that had come over to work in the Davis ore mine. They all lived up there together in the settlement. I don't suppose it was any racial force or violence, but they could never agree on anything. They always tried to settle their differences with their fists, and nobody ever won. The story is that one time the settlement looked like the battlefield at Gettysburg. There was one very outstanding character named Paul Cody. Sometimes he spelled his name C-O-D-I or C-O-D-Y. He was from Austria. He was the strong man of the settlement. He was also taking things. He would never steal, he just borrowed. One day, he took one of those great big iron kettles that the miners had in the mining camp and moved it from Perkins' lot way up the hill on Lincoln City to his own house. And it took a team of horses and three men to bring it back down. Then he had another habit. I said he was always taking things. There was a row of houses that had no cellars, so they were quite cold in the winter. They used to bank the houses with straw or hay. Well, Paul Cody used to come down and he'd burrow under the haystack and go up the road carrying the haystack on his shoulders. The people, some of them boys, were beginning to distress their hard cider when they saw a haystack coming walking up the road. But things were already changing for the Irish and for everyone in Salisbury. As I said, the Ames Ironworks closed in 1871. The Housatonic Railroad's shops, which succeeded the Ames Ironworks. The railroad shops filled that space from 1872. They were abandoned finally in 1904. The Ore Hill Mine stopped operation in 1923. And the last blast furnace, which was East Canaan number 3, shut down in 1923 as well. The workers were essentially forced to relocate in order to find employment. There's evidence that some went to nearby manufacturing centers, such as Pittsfield. In fact, in the article that I read a bit to you before from the Free Press of Canaan, it talks about how she, the reporter, was trying to find the legacy of some of the families who once lived on Dublin Road, and she was able to track down a lady who had spent some years on Dublin Road but was now living in Pittsfield, and she was told that a number of the people who used to live in and around here moved up there for the manufacturing jobs that were then available in Pittsfield. Railroad construction in the West. There was a large percentage of Irish workers who worked with the Union Pacific Railroad on the transcontinental job that was finished in 1869. The coal mines of western Pennsylvania, eastern Kentucky, and West Virginia also had large percentages of Irish workers. Between 1910 and 1920, the overall population of the town of Salisbury declined by 29%. Over 1,000 people left. And gradually, we saw the change of the economic activity in the town and the real promotion of the name Lakeville. We switched from agriculture and industry and manufacturing to education, service, and leisure. And that's where we are to this day. But on this St. Patrick's Day, even though I'm not Irish, I do wish to leave you with this blessing and to say that the legacy of the Irish in Salisbury is the legacy of all immigrants in America. They came seeking new opportunities. They found them. Sometimes they had to continue seeking new opportunities. They had to keep moving. But that's the history of our country. They contributed mightily to our identity as a nation. And I hope that we continue to accept the hard work, the dedication, and the passion for life and progress that immigrants bring to our country. Thank you very much.
Bell hasn't rung yet, and Bill will take a few questions. You're also welcome to move.
Yes?
How long did the school and the convent operate?
They operated, I believe, to the late 1920s, the school in particular. The convent was occupied by nuns right up through the 1960s, I believe. I did have an article on the Lakeville Manor and used that Father Joseph Forte, he tried to get it to be used by the town for various different functions in later years when they were contemplating closing the convent. They wanted to be able to, you know, make some income, make some money, to be able to support the building itself. I don't believe it was sold. I don't believe that the Hartford Archdiocese sold it until the 1980s. So it was connected to the church all those years. Yes?
The window from St. Patrick's has ended up in Canaan, as in North Canaan.
Right. I hadn't, no, but they're in storage, is that correct? Or are they actually being...
If you drive up 7,
yep.
If you go straight over the lights by the fire station here,
okay.
And you look left, it's in that new extension.
Oh, wonderful,
yeah.
Wonderful. I knew they had been preserved. When the Diocese of Hartford sold the original chapel, I knew that they had removed them and
yeah.
Moved them up to St. Joseph's, because in those later years, St. Patrick's was an extension and annex of the
St.
Joseph's. Yeah.
It wasn't the daughter originally, but it ended up being the daughter church. Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
And in Falls Village, the Patrick Kelly's house is still in existence. It's the Chinnadi's house, Roland Chinnadi.
Oh, okay, sure, on Warren Turnpike.
And if you go down towards the high school on the same side of the road and hike up the hill and close, you know, close to the railroad lines, there's the cornerstone of the Catholic church there.
Oh, wonderful.
Because I went up with, I took Ellen Paul, who works with Pat Conroy.
Okay.
I took her up there in the summer.
Oh, that's exciting.
Yeah.
I'll have to look for that.
Yeah.
Summer. Thank you.
Yes? Hi, Lou. I seem to remember, I think there were two waves of immigration from the, is that true? Like 20 years later, there was another big wave of Irish coming in?
Towards the end of the 19th century, that is true. It wasn't as massive as the original one during the mid-19th century, but it did exist. And it kind of got diluted by the fact that there were an awful lot of other immigrants coming at the same time during the heyday of Ellis Island and the like, yes. They certainly weren't coming to Salisbury in the same numbers that they had once come. Right, exactly. The iron industry was already going into decline, and they just weren't. The railroads were fairly well built. The CNE, which was the one east-west line, had been finished by then. And so there just weren't the employment opportunities here that had existed earlier in the 19th century.
Can I ask one more question?
Yes.
You get to ask a great question.
In this area, do the Irish come from any particular area of Ireland, more or less?
Not that I was able to document. There didn't seem to be as many Ulstermen coming from the Northeast, the areas that were controlled by Great Britain and which Protestants dominated. But other than that, I wasn't able to tell.
Louis, thank you very much.
Oh, my pleasure.